This is the North Carolina Auto Racing Hall of Fame in Mooresville, the site of today's show. Hi, I'm Alan Bestwick. Thanks for joining us. Today we visit with one of the great legends of stock car racing, man who was perhaps the smoothest there ever was on dirt. I speak of Dick Hutcherson. Born in Iowa, had a great driving career, went on to fame as a mechanic and crew chief and car builder. Johnny Hayes sat down and talked with Dick about his brief but very successful NASCAR racing career. We'll hear that conversation in just a minute. Stick around.
Now, you're from Iowa, and how do you pronounce the name of the town you're from?
Kilcook.
Kilcook, Iowa.
No, you didn't say it right. Kilcook.
Keokuk.
Right, you're getting closer.
Keokuk, Iowa. Mm-hmm. How did you get to Winston Cup Racing from Keokuk, Iowa? Let me simplify that. How did you get in motorsports, and how old were you when you started?
Probably 24 or 25. I got out of the service and started running local tracks. Some of my buddies was, and run a few years at the local tracks there at Kilcook.
Well, there were a bunch of people from your area, weren't they? It's legendary type.
Yeah, Kilcook had a big billboard outside of town, home of the champions. I don't know who they're talking about. Ernie Durr, Don White, Ramo. There's quite a few of us come out of Kilcook.
Now, how did you get the break to come NASCAR? You were having a lot of success up north, and where did the break come to get the big ride?
Like I said, I started running the new type cars in 59. Ford started helping me in 63. And I won over half the races that we run out there in 63 and 4, and they asked me if I wanted to come and run NASCAR. And that's where the racing was. And yeah, I wanted to come. No, I moved to North Carolina, worked for Holman Moody. I worked on my own car, got paid for working on my own car, and then plus I drove it.
Why don't you explain to our friends what Holman Moody really was?
Back in the 60s, if you was going to race a Ford, the place to get parts for a Ford race car would be Holman Moody. Holman Moody did all of Ford's race projects. We had about 250 employees, I think.
Now, you had to, even though you were the big-time hero driver, you also had to go to work on Monday and work on the race car, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Now, some of the drivers didn't, but I'd always worked on my own car, and I just felt like I had a better rapport with my own car.
So you worked on it because you liked to work on it or felt more
exactly.
comfortable with
mm-hmm.
it? They didn't make you work on the car?
No. No.
You did it by choice.
Freddie Lorenzen didn't work on his car. He was driving for Holman Moody at the same time.
Now, what are the drivers' names that were racing with you at Holman Moody when you came in?
Marvin Panch.
Well, it was a great stable of heroes.
Oh, yeah.
And I think everyone that grew up, for sure when I did, Holman Moody was...
Junior. Ned, you know.
Junior Johnson,
Jarrett. Ned Jarrett. Yeah. Let me tell you, both them guys, along with David Pearson, was tough guys on dirt. Yeah, they were tough on asphalt too, but when I come down, they were tough on dirt.
Turner and Dave Pearson duel back and forth. Roy Tyner spins clear of the track. Ned Jarrett is backwards. Paul Goldsmith is blocked for the moment.
Y'all got along pretty good, didn't you?
Oh, we, you know, Richard Petty and Ned Jarrett, we all stayed at the same motel, worked on our cars in the parking lots. We were good friends.
Yeah.
But when we got on the racetrack, it was every man for himself. And sure, you'd have some differences once in a while, but it would be forgotten before the next race, you know. This is where the publicity was at. This is where, you know, if you was a racer, you wanted to be down south running NASCAR.
How were you treated being, I think even, I hate to say Yankee, but I think Iowa was northern. Did they treat you like
that? I told
them
I wasn't a Yankee. I was a Midwesterner.
Midwesterner.
Yeah. And sure, you had to come down here. You had to prove yourself. If you come down here and thought you was better than these guys, well, they'd teach you right quick you wasn't better than them guys, you know.
Right.
Coming down here and running against these guys, I guess, was, you know, the highlight of my career. The first race I ever come down here, I sat on the pole.
The first event?
First event.
Ooh.
I was pretty proud of that, you know.
Yeah, I would say.
This was on dirt.
On dirt.
Just like, you know, just like the track from the Midwest. Holes about a foot deep.
So it wasn't a big transition for
you? No. I was right at home. Now, the transition was when we pulled into Daytona Beach, and I saw this asphalt stretched out as far as you could see.
The car behind us, that was a great year. You won.
That was the year I come down here.
Mm-hmm. You won like 9 races?
Yeah.
Your rookie year?
Yeah. Finished second in the points to Ned Jarrett. Mm-hmm. John Holman, I had a ride with Holman Moody for 1968, but John says, why don't you come and be my assistant? And so you're always thinking, well, now what am I going to do when I quit driving? You know, you got to do something.
Right.
And he offered me good money. He says, if you come, he says, we'll get David Pearson to drive, and you'll be the manager over his car. And you'd be my assistant. So I did that, and David won the championship in 68 and 69. We practically lived together.
And how long did it take you to make that transition to saying, okay, I don't want to drive these things anymore? Or have you made it yet?
Yeah, I've made it. I'd rather be in an electric chair with a drunkard switch and be back in one of those things now. But I think probably 4 or 5 years, then it kind of mellowed out a little bit, and you went on, and 4 years later, I opened Hutcherson-Pagan, Eddie Pagan and myself, and it's been good to us.
Yeah, and y'all built some of the best race cars, continue to do so.
A lot of super trucks, a lot of Winston Cup, a lot of Busch cars, and Eddie passed away probably 12 years ago, and I brought my brother down from the Midwest, and he also drove.
He told me he really had more talent than you. He just didn't have the backing and the money that you had. Is that true, you think? I mean, that's just what he told me. I don't know that.
He was good. He won the ARCA championship a few times, and he'd come down here. You remember he drove one of AJ's cars? He qualified second, and AJ qualified third. AJ didn't like that. No, it was all right. It was AJ's car. But he had a lot of talent, and now he runs Hutcherson-Pagan.
Yeah.
And I'm semi-retired.
How did you get involved with AJ? Where did y'all develop such a close relationship?
Well, I'd met AJ. He used to run sprint cars in IMCA, him and Parnelli Jones. And they'd run like maybe on a track in the afternoon. We'd run the next day or something. So I knew AJ, but then we started racing together down here. And after we opened Hutcherson-Pagan, I said, let us build your stock cars for you, because he'd run some USAC and some NASCAR. And so in the 70s, we started building his stock cars, and I was crew chief in his cars, and we just had a good relationship. He's not near as hard as he'd like you to think. You know that.
Yes.
Yeah, he's a little soft sometimes.
Time Indianapolis 500 mile champion AJ Foyt has an engine detonate and adds another chapter to his unique collection of thrilling moments.
But we was in Daytona one time. I don't remember the boy's name, but he had to borrow a set of tires to get in the qualifying race. You know, they really didn't have no business there, and the boy got killed in the race. He told me, he says, Dick, you go find that kid's dad and give him whatever money he needs to get that boy home. And he said, I don't want nobody to know where it came from. And I did.
During his brief career in NASCAR, Dick Hutcherson captured 22 pole positions and 14 wins, all but one on short tracks. His lone Super Speedway victory came in 1967 in the Dixie 500 at the Atlanta International Raceway.
Were you being creative with the rules in those days to give you some kind of advantage?
Well, you know, we didn't know a lot about aerodynamics and stuff then, but one instance comes to my mind that we was getting ready to go to Daytona in 1966. Ralph Moody come by and he says, you know, boys, if we lay that windshield down a little bit, the car probably run a little faster. So we got creative. There wasn't no templates back then, Johnny. And we laid the windshield down a little bit, dropped the front fenders a little bit, and we go to Daytona. And we don't know. There's no wind tunnel. We don't know what's going to happen. I think we lapped Freddie Lorenzen in about 20 laps. I mean, the car, I sat on the outside pole. Richard beat me. Of course, Richard was tough, so if you run second to Richard, you wasn't doing too bad. But the car would fly. And then I think after that, Junior come up with that yellow banana.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Real creative.
Right, yeah. Right.
Eddie Pagan, we haven't talked about him, was one of the neatest gentlemen.
Gentlemen, yeah, that's it.
When, you know, you built, when we started with Travis Carter sponsoring the car and the Skull Bandit car, we used the Hutcherson-Pagan cars.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Pagan was such a gentleman on everything.
He was a nice guy out of the partners.
Yeah, yeah, you were the one that would kick everybody's fanny.
Yeah, I was the one that done the yelling and stuff, and he was the one that kept everything calm down and a super guy.
How did y'all get together to decide we can build these race cars?
Eddie was in charge of the fab shop at Holman Moody when I went down there, and so we got to be pretty good friends. You know, we'd go out and eat together. And then after I quit driving, John Holman then made me general manager, and he says, now you pick out whoever you want for an assistant. And I picked Eddie. And then when we decided to leave Holman Moody, and we left on good terms with John and Ralph, we opened Hutcherson-Pagan. And the name will always be Hutcherson-Pagan. Eddie was a part of it.
Yeah. That's really neat because...
He's a super guy.
And not a bad race car driver, was he?
A good race. He drove for Foyt back before my time, you know. Yeah. Sat on the pole at Darlington. In fact, he went through the wall at Darlington, didn't he?
Yeah, that
over the wall. Mm-hmm.
Ugly guardrail scene you see his car on.
Super guy. Everybody liked Eddie.
When you started building cars, you were working for Holman Moody and had to deal with the people there. But then you started building cars and you're trying to get the teams in Winston Cup to run your chassis. Was that hard to do? What was the going chassis in those days?
Banjo. Back then, it was tough, but we'd made a lot of good friends, Eddie and I, in racing. Roger Penske come along, wanted us to do the Matador for him, so we did that, and at that time we'd build the car, we'd take it to the racetrack and crew it, the whole bit, you know, and Mark Donahue was driving the car, and it was tough, but then it just kept snowballing a little bit.
Penske crew did a great job on Donahue's car. They get him out quick, and the Matador has the lead. Mark's Matador is number one and moving away. He's outlasted most of the competition. Petty went out with a broken timing chain. Fastest qualifier David Pearson had the clutch let go in his Purolator Mercury. And Buddy Baker went out early in the race when his K&K Dodge lost oil pressure. All of which means there's a lot of top drivers watching in the pits as Mark Donahue pilots his American Motors Matador under the checkered flag. Winner of the Winston Western 500.
Atlanta, Georgia. High bank like Daytona, but a mile and a half instead of 2.5 miles. Richard Petty leads from the pole. Beside him, Dick Hutcherson. Monkey Blackburn blows an engine. He almost takes Joe Thomas with him.
When we look back at the numbers of people, Ray Everham recently said he'd like to thank the 150 people back at the shop that helped develop the car that Jeff Gordon was so strong in at Charlotte. And I heard that number and it blew me away. I didn't realize it had grown to the, there's like 50 people to a team with four or five engineers, all kinds of specialists in those areas. But that's getting to be a common thing, isn't it?
It is. It is. They have a tire specialist, a shock specialist, you know, an engineer and a chassis specialist. It's a crew chief is more of a manager now.
Now, when you built this car, how many people did y'all have working on this car versus the 50 we have today?
There was three of us that put the car together. Of course, now if we got in a wreck, there was a body shop there that fixed the fenders and so on, or the frame, you know. But basically, we had three people. We'd have a couple of dirt track cars, a couple of short track cars, and a super speedway car. We didn't take a backup car when we went to the racetrack. We went to the racetrack, and we were going to race that car.
You've seen it go from an affordable sport to really a big time, like owning an NFL team. It's owning a Winston Cup team now, with there being 40 teams, maybe 35 teams, it's just like owning a franchise in NFL or something.
What these guys spend on a hauler these days, Johnny, we could have run all year on, you know, just on their hauler. When I first come down here in the 60s, everybody had a one-ton truck with a trailer behind it, towing their race car. It's come a long way. I don't think these drivers maybe have as much fun. There's a lot more pressure on them, a lot more commitments on them. I think we used to have a little more fun. Yeah, and you know, you didn't do the testing back there like you do now. You didn't go to Daytona and test, you know, a month before you was going to run there. When I saw Daytona is when I pulled in there.
Just drove it.
Yeah.
And what kind of feeling was it when you drive through the tunnel? I guess I had a tunnel in those days.
Mm-hmm, right? The same one.
And drive in and look, and you sit there and say, what was your feeling?
And you know that track's narrow when you're out there. I had a lot of good help. Like I said, Ned Jarrett helped me a lot, but I had Ralph Moody, Holman Moody, you know. So I knew that right springs were in the car, and you know. And just kind of, we just kind of built up to the speed, you know. And we was probably running 170 back then. I think in 67 we ran 180, you know. When you got to Daytona, the hardest thing was trying to tell that foot it's supposed to stay on the floor.
Hold it.
When you got to the corner, the toes start curl up. So you'd have to take your left foot and put over there.
How was Darlington, first time you hit that place? I mean, did you hit that place?
Yeah, I did.
First time
oh,
you
yeah.
raced there.
Well, you remember the track back then, if you didn't have the right side wore out, you wasn't running fast, you know. After you hit the wall, then that's when you was running at Darlington.
The Darlington strut.
Yeah, the Darlington strut. We used to put a spring leaf in the right rear quarter panel. So, you know, when it'd wear through the sheet metal, it'd rub against that spring leaf.
No.
Yeah.
So y'all on purpose leaned it against the wall.
You tried not to, but if you was running fast, you was going to slide that wall. Yeah.
When you drove for Holman Moody, and you had four or five teams racing out of basically one building, did y'all work together on everything, share all information, or was it a competitive situation?
Oh, no. It was very competitive. Freddie had his part of the shop. There was walls between. We had our part of the shop. You didn't go in each other's shop. And, you know, when we went to the racetrack, I wanted to, you know, if I didn't win the race, I wanted to at least be the fastest Ford. If we'd come up with a little trick to try at the racetrack, we wouldn't tell Freddie's guys about it, you know. It was going to be to our advantage.
So when you got to the racetrack, there was no big giant.
We wouldn't tell Moody about it either, because he like might go tell Freddie's guys.
So if you found an advantage, don't tell anybody.
Exactly.
Is there any things that you look back on and say, that was magic in my career?
Really, one thing I don't think we've talked about, that, you know, I probably wouldn't want to do it again. I know I wouldn't at the age I am now. But when Foyt and NASCAR had a little dispute there in 1966, Marvin Panch and I went and tested the GT40. And to go to Le Mans, we went and cast it at Danville, Virginia, and Riverside, and Kingman, Arizona. And they asked us if we wanted to go over there. Well, that was kind of a prestige race. You know, it didn't pay real good. And, you know, you can't eat prestige. Those things didn't have no roll cage in them. The engine was behind you. No, I don't think so. Well, A.J. got burnt in Milwaukee that year, and he was supposed to go. And they called me at the last minute and said, will you change your mind? So we worked out an agreement, and I went. I finished third, and that was quite an experience.
In 24 hours of Le Mans.
24 hours of Le Mans. And just finishing 24 hours of Le Mans is something over there. You're a hero to those people if you just finish.
Yeah.
And Foyt finished first, second, and third.
Dick, did you ever have any desire to drive an Indy car, being from Iowa and the success of people in that area with Indy
After
cars?
I had run down here in 65, and Foyt was having that dispute in 66, I had a chance to drive the Bardol Special, they called me. And I figured that was a compliment. You know, they called and wanted to know if I'd be interested in running Indy. And I said no, because I didn't even like watching them races, you know. And I thought those guys were nuts.
Yeah.
They didn't have no roll cage.
I'm sure at the same time they look at y'all and see y'all going into Daytona at the room four wide stuff and saying, these
exactly,
Winston Cup guys are crazy. It was like two totally different sports.
It was.
Open wheel.
It was.
Mm-hmm.
But I had no desire to really run a sprint car. I like that stock car with a roof over my head.
Former NASCAR Winston Cup champion Ned Jarrett said Dick Hutcherson was perhaps the best driver he ever raced against on dirt. That's quite a compliment from Ned. Hope you enjoyed today's show. Join us again next time on The Legends of Stock Car Racing. I'm Alan Bestbook. We'll see you then.
Daytona. You had told me one time y'all were getting ready to start the race or whatever, and you had informed me that AJ had a flight out at like 3:30 and the race wouldn't be over to 5:30. So for me not to make any long-term plans on the driver, is that a true story?
Now, if AJ was running first or second, if he was running up front, he would stay and catch that flight. We was at Darlington one time now, and he'd never went to Darlington before. You know, Darlington's not an easy place to get around, so we really wasn't setting the world on fire. He come on the radio and he says, Hutch, how many laps is this race? And I told him, he says, you reckon I ought to quit about 300 and we beat the traffic out of here? I said, as far as I'm concerned, we wasn't running with a day. I said, as far as I'm concerned, you can quit right now. Here he come in the pits and we left.